Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Oath of the Gatewatch. I'm Marshall Seckliff in the booth with R&D insider Ian Duke, and we're ready for our first of two semifinal matches. This first one features JC Tao, Seattle area player. He plays for East West Bowl. This is his third Pro Tour. That's the end of that sentence. On the other side of the table, we've got Luis Scott-Vargas. This is his sixth Pro Tour top eight, so clearly the more experienced player out of the two. He's from Team Channel Fireball, and they are all ready to go. A quick note about the matchup here, Ian. They're both playing Eldrazi, but slightly different versions, actually significantly different versions of that take.
Yep, that's right. Luis is on what we're calling Colorless Eldrazi. This is the one with fewer creatures, Chalice of the Void, Simian Spirit Guide. JC Tao on Blue-Red Eldrazi. This is the East-West Bowl. Team deck.
Whoa, big start here for JC Tao. He's got two Eldrazi Mimics on turn one off of Eye of Ugin, and that also allows him to play Endless One for two. And all of a sudden, Luis, even though he's on the play here, being the higher seed, he is way behind facing six power.
Yes, indeed.
Whoa.
So big attack coming in from JC, and the hits are going to keep coming, perhaps not this turn, but I do see a Reality Smasher in JC's hand with a couple of Eldrazi Temples coming up. So perhaps not this turn, but the turn after, we will be seeing a lot of smashing coming down here, Marshall.
Yeah, there's plenty of smashing going on right now, Ian. Now, if I'm sitting in Luis Scott-Vargas' seat, what needs to happen for me to get out of this?
Yikes. Well, he does have one copy of Dismember, which can take out one of those creatures, but I do fear this draw might be a little too fast.
God, this deck is so explosive.
So actually, there is one really neat trick here, Marshall. So Reality Smashers is going to come down here, I believe, this turn. Yes, indeed. And because Luis has Dismember, there's actually a really interesting interaction here. He can Dismember the Reality Smasher, which isn't just a kill spell. It actually gives the Reality Smasher -5/-5. And the important interaction here is when the Eldrazi Mimics look to copy the Reality Smasher, they're looking at a 0/0 creature since it did get -5/-5 from Dismember. So JC will have to decline to copy the Reality Smasher with those Mimics. He can still attack with them, but they're just 2/1 creatures instead of, you know, 3/5/5s coming in this turn.
Right.
And we may see him actually decline to attack with Mimics because I see a copy of Drowner of Hope in his hand. So he may be planning next turn, I'm going to play the Drowner, and now I'll make the Mimics 5/5s and crash in. So big, big play there from Luis, but it's only the start of what he needs to come back into this game.
So Endless One's attacking here.
And Luis sitting on just two cards left in hand.
He's going to drop down to 8 life here, Ian. And he is going to need to find a land and start adding some really impressive things to the board. And this counts as that. And yep. He's attacking for 10 here.
A nice pickup for Luis there. I like this aggressive play. He's basically conceding the fact that if JC has another big Eldrazi to play, the Mimics will copy it. And Luis will die, but his best chance of winning is just to get in there. Of course, he doesn't know JC's hand. We do. And here comes the Drowner of Hopes. That's a 5/5, and so are those Mimics, and Luis packs it up.
All right, so that was it. A quick game one goes to JC Tao. And, put on your seatbelts here at home, kiddos, because these matches go very quickly. You are not going to want to step away from your screen. We'll be back right after these messages.
Qualify for the next Pro Tour on Magic Online. Go 5-0 or 4-1 in a preliminary to advance to the finals. You can see the full schedule at mtgo.com. Put your game to the test at a Grand Prix. These open tournaments feature the best players in your region as well as top Magic pros from around the world. Upcoming Grand Prix include Houston, Melbourne, Bologna, Detroit, Washington, D.C., and Paris. Visit magic.wizards.com/Grand Prix for a complete schedule.
And welcome back to the feature match area here in Atlanta. So players are moving on to sideboards here, Ian, and we actually had a chance to get a little minute of their time to see how they were going to sideboard for the matchup.
I'm here with JC Tao. JC, tell me what your plans are for the sideboard. You've got as many as 4 sideboarded games to play. What cards are going to come into play here for you in this matchup?
To start with, it's not great. we configured our main deck to be already good against big monster decks, kind of like what the Channel Fireball guys are running. Therefore, we shaved a lot of slots in the sideboard to protect ourselves against other smaller, quicker decks. What I did against Shuhei is bring in extra land most of the time. They do have four ghost quarters, and they seem very keen on destroying our lands. And sometimes, when it comes to just having the explosive draw you need, you just want to be able to cast your spells at the expense of having fewer spells in your hand. So the land comes in. The Ratchet Bomb sometimes comes in, depending on how aggressive you feel like your opponent is doing. They are very good at destroying endless ones. They are also okay at destroying the Mimics as well as the Spellskite, which your opponent will probably be bringing in post-board. And then the last card I bring in are the Gutshots. They are, again, good at preventing yourself from dying to just a very explosive draw of Mimics. And late game, they prevent your opponent from blocking your Sky Spawners with Ink Moth, which is also very key. But yeah, that's pretty much it in terms of what I bring in.
Okay, good games the rest of the way here in the top eight.
Thank you.
All right, Luis, tell me what the plan is. You got as many as four sideboarded games. What's the plan with these cards? How do you try to turn this matchup around?
My plan is to play three Eldrazi Mimics on turn one and a Reality Smasher on turn two. But barring that, I do have a plan.
Then you win the team pool?
Right. I don't think anyone actually did that. But this matchup's kind of weird because you want cards like Oblivion Source. I'm boarding those three in because they're really powerful, you know, when you're battling over Eye of Ugin's and Ghost Quarters and that sort of thing. But the matchup's also really fast. I'm boarding in three Gutshots because I want to kill Eldrazi Mimics and, Eldrazi Obligators and Eldrazi Sky Spawners and every kind of Eldrazi that's floating around or my opponent if they're at one. But mostly it's because that's a cheap, relevant card. And that's it. I'm just boarding in those six cards.
And what do you take out to make room for them?
So we're still debating that. well, what we know is we're taking out four Chalice of the Void. That card is very bad in the mirror. Everyone just has expensive spells. Yours are like the same cost as theirs. So that's definitely coming out. The team's actually divided on whether to take out Spellskite or Ratchet Bomb. They both have their pluses and minuses. Spellskite can stop Drowner of Hope and Eldrazi Obligator. It can retarget those effects. Though at two life each, I have no blue sources. And Ratchet Bomb can kill Scion tokens and Endless One, though it kills my own Endless Ones as well. So I'm leaning towards Spellskite, but I'm going to go play some more games, try to figure out a little bit better. Like I said, my team played a bunch of games, and just different people like different things, so I'm going to talk to them as well.
All right, well, good games the rest of the way here in the top eight.
And once again, welcome back here to Atlanta. We're in our first semifinal match, and Ian, I thought this would be a good moment to remind everybody watching at home how we're actually structuring the top eight this time around.
Yeah, so each of these top eight matches, not just the finals, is best of five games, which means the first game is played with the main deck configurations, and then there are up to four sideboarded games. So sideboarding becomes a lot more important in these matches, Marshall.
Okay, and it looks like, yeah, you seeing this here, Ian? JC has a little, before we do anything else, he has an effect.
Luis putting the luck counter on his opponent's permanent there, a true gentleman.
So that's a Gemstone Caverns there for JC.
I enjoy that it's literally a luck counter.
It actually says luck counter on it. All right. Good start here from Luis, though. He kicks off with a turn one Eldrazi Mimic and then a Matter Reshaper on turn two. He is going to make his Mimic into a 3-2 and crunch in there. Nothing yet for Tao. Not quite as explosive as a start as JC had in the first game, but Luis is off to a reasonable opener here, especially if he can play a Thoughtknot Seer here on turn three. No, it looks like he's just on the beatdown plan. He's going to attack for six damage here.
Yeah, JC with a little bit more of a reactive draw this game. Taking a peek at his hand, as we do have access to here, looks like he's got a pair of Reality Smashers and a pair of Dismembers.
So he's going to look to leverage these Dismembers in the early part of the game to keep his life total high and then clean up this mess with some Reality Smashers, though. He does decide to take out the Blink Moth Nexus here with that first Dismember at the expense of taking an extra damage or two, and there's a Thoughtknot Seer.
Yeah, taking out the Blink Moth Nexus there, I like that a lot. It's It's not necessarily an obvious play since he is taking damage from the dismember itself and a bunch of damage from the attack. But basically, you know, stone raining your opponent in this matchup is a huge, huge thing, preventing them from getting up to Thought Knots and Reality Smashers and even larger.
Yeah, that was a nice one there for JC Tao. He did find a Thought Knots here, which takes away the Oblivion Sower of Luis Scott-Vargas. Now, Luis was a little ways off from casting that Oblivion Sower, but that's the type of card that he needs to keep the board stable and turn things back in his direction. We've seen Oblivion Sower do a lot of work here in the quarterfinals as well. And there's a Ratchet Bomb now for Tao. So not a super strong follow-up play, but he's going to leaf back his Thought Knot Seer on defense.
Yeah, these Eldrazi matchups, they're a lot about just who has the biggest body on board. Like that, you can see that Thought Knot Seer just holding off the Matter Reshaper and the Eldrazi Mimic. Then Reality Smasher is a, sort of a one-up from that, and then the Oblivion Sower is even a one-up from that, with Endless One sort of filling in the curve wherever you need to be, wherever you need to block your opponent's creatures. So yeah, big monsters for sure, as JC Tao put it.
So Luis is just going to get in there for one damage with Blinkmoth Nexus, play a land and pass. So it looks like Luis is pretty out of gas here after getting Thought Knot Seared there. And the sum total of his attacks for the turn was just a single point.
Yeah, that Thought Knot definitely a big deal because Luis's draw is land heavy and he's got a great set of lands here. You know, two creature lands, actually three with the first Blinkmoth Nexus as well, and two Eldrazi Temples. So that turn would have been... Ghost Quarter and Eldrazi Temple. So coming up here real soon would be Oblivion Sower, but unfortunately stripped away by Thought Knot Seer. So we'll see what Luis can come up with this turn.
Eldrazi Mimic is the only play from Tao. So this game plodding along at a much different pace than game one, where we saw Tao have six power on his first turn of the game and able to ride that to the victory. Luis is going to go ahead and attack with Matter Reshaper and just cash it in. He actually is even going to get a chance to trade it off there. So he's got to be happy about that. And right off the top of the library, he finds an Endless One.
Oh, that's a huge deal here.
That is going to be a 7-7 Endless One. Right after the Ratchet Bomb had ticked up to one as well, he's going to go ahead and bring it up to two. JC Tao realizing that he was going to lose his Mimic in that interaction anyway, so he went ahead and traded it off for the Matter Reshaper, preserving the Thought Knot Seer.
Yeah, the fact that Ratchet Bomb was already on one counter there was a huge deal for Luis. In fact, I believe JC brings in the Ratchet Bomb specifically just to deal with Endless Ones. And looking at the sideboard plan here, it looks like JC took out his own Endless Ones as well to sort of support that plan.
Here's a Vile Aggregate now for JC Tao, which doesn't look that amazing here facing down this 7-7. Though it does open up a pretty reasonable scenario down the line where JC may be able to put a double block on the 7-7 and only lose one creature.
Yeah, definitely. And Vile Aggregate can grow very, very rapidly in JC Tao's deck. He's got things like Drowner of Hope, producing multiple creatures. Even an Eldrazi Sky Spawner represents two more power for the Aggregate.
Yeah.
So we could see a world where the Vile Aggregate actually grows up to a size where it can challenge that Endless One.
Yeah, it's close. It's already a 2-5. But unfortunately, that's only six total power there for Tao, and the Endless One at 7-7 trumps that. Luis is still on 20 life here. He's got Tao down to 9. And Luis is going to activate both the Mutavault, the Blinkmoth, and he is sending the team everything into the red zone here for Luis Scott-Vargas. He is looking to close the door on this game as soon as possible.
Yeah, so the tough thing here for JC is, you know, if he blocks the Mutavault and the Eldrazi Mimic with his two creatures, then he takes 8.
Goes to one,
and then the Blinkmoth Nexus represents lethal the following turn. So it's putting JC in a really tough spot here where the blocks he wants to make are not the blocks that he can make.
I just saw something here, Ian.
What's that?
Luis has a gut shot in his hand.
Oh.
You heard him make a little joke during the sideboard video that we just showed. He said, oh, we're opponents who are on one life, which that actually happened yesterday.
Yeah, and it could have happened this very same turn,
too. It could have, too, but JC is playing around, well, that and other things here. He's also going to use Dismember here during combat.
Yeah,
That does put JC down to 5, and he's still taking a damage this turn. And that turned out pretty well for JC Tao. He got to eat a Mutavault and finish off the Endless One, and it's going to be an Eldrazi Mimic here for Scott-Vargas. JC Tao down at a precarious 4 life. But that's a long way to go for Luis if he's going to have to get in there with the Blink Moth Nexus 3 times to combine with the Gut Shot to finish off Tao. Remember, JC also runs Eldrazi Sky Spawners in this deck that he could find. It looks like Ruination Guide is his play for this turn, though.
Yeah, so that's going to mean 9 damage coming in, actually, from that Vile Aggregate and Thought Not Seer. Drops Luis to 11.
See if Luis can find a way to finish off this game here. He's been ahead for the duration of this game, but it may be turning back in the other direction. It's a Matter Reshaper, and he's going to attack with both, immediately blocked by Tao. So is the Eldrazi Mimic, so Tao falls down to 3.
Oh, and it's Eye of Ugin off the top there for Tao. I believe he's been sitting on 2 Reality Smashers for quite some time here.
Is that enough to kill Luis here? No. Ooh, this is a close one, Ian. We're going to see a couple of draw steps here, and then we're going to decide who wins the second game. Right now, JC Tao's up a game over Luis. There's the Eye of Ugin. And there's Reality Smasher. Now, he can present a lethal attack here, but Luis does have the ability to interact with it by blocking with his Matter Reshaper.
Yeah, and the trouble is, depending on what comes off the Matter Reshaper, that could represent a lethal crackback for Luis, if it's something like, you know, a Mutavault or an Eldrazi Mimic. So it looks like, JC does go for it.
He's going for it, though, in with the team.
So he's hoping to fade something that can go directly into play off of the Matter Reshaper. And also a Reality Smasher from Luis would be the other thing.
I think a second Blink Moth would do it, too. Luis,
right,
still at a precarious... Luis also, by the way, does have a Simian Spirit Guide in his hand, just in case his life total falls low. Oh, and it's a Reality Smasher off the top for Luis Scott-Vargas.
So
He's gonna... Wow, so insane. So he had 2 different triggers there, one for the Matter Reshaper and one for the Ingest. And it turns out that if it was flipped the other way, things wouldn't have gone quite as well for Luis.
Yep,
but the card that he ended up drawing was Reality Smasher. He shows it to him and says, I will play this and attack you with it. And that, in fact, ends game number 2. So all tied up at a game apiece here in semifinal number 1. There were quite a few cards that he could find there with that reshape.
Yeah, it was definitely a calculated risk by JC, but I think the attack made sense, like, percentage-wise.
Yeah.
And it just worked out that Luis got it there.
All right, well, you know, one of the cards that's really stood out to me, Ian, especially as one that may have been easy to overlook at first, is Reality Smasher, the card that just won that game for Luis Scott-Vargas and nearly won it for JC. I mean, he was also attacking with his own copy of that card. And it's really funny because, you know, you don't often think of cards like this that are kind of tricky to cast, and they have this decidedly aggressive bend to them, right, as being, you know, staples or cards that you're necessarily going to see in formats like Modern. But this guy is scary.
It's for real, definitely. It is a strong card. In my preview article, I likened it to Thundermaw Hellkite in some ways. Just, you know, 5 hasty power, got some disruptive elements to it. One cool thing about this is originally it cost CCCC for colorless mana, and it was kind of like a Phyrexian Obliterator type design there, what was supposed to be the big reward for going heavy colorless. As we worked on the set more, we actually found we were having trouble integrating colorless into other decks, and we didn't want it to just be like, there's an all-colorless deck, and it's super strong, and it sort of moves as a chunk through Standard with Oath of the Gatewatch and doesn't really gain or lose anything. So we actually integrated the colorless cards more into other decks, so you might be able to, say, splash this card off of the Pain Land in your Obzon deck or something like that in Standard. There's a little bit more interesting play and interesting deck building to it now.
What's the difference from your perspective? And for those of you at home that don't know, Ian was a lead developer for Oath of the Gatewatch, so he knows of what he speaks here. So what would be the difference if you were going to change the mana cost to 3cc, and C is the shorthand, by the way, for colorless, versus 4C. How big of a gap is that?
It's a very big gap for building standard decks. If you want to build a colored deck in standard that has colorless mana in it as well, you've got sort of your 8 pain lands. Maybe you fit in a couple extra special colorless lands, but it's really, really hard to get that double colorless. So we found that when we had anything more than one colorless mana in this in the mana cost of this card, it was really only going in the very specialized colorless decks, and it didn't really lead to interesting deck building.
Right, and so that went away from your guys' goal of what you were talking about earlier.
That's
with
right.
The CCCC, where everything's kind of bunched together in one deck. Interesting stuff. Great insight there, Ian. And that's a great name.
Yeah.
By the way, I know that's not your department.
I actually love the names in this set. I had nothing to do with actually naming the cards. You know, we just play with whatever wacky playtest names. But I love the, like, kind of metaphysical, weird type names here, like Warden of Geometries and, you know, all this crazy stuff here.
Sure.
It's a lot of fun.
All right, looks like the players are ready for game three here as we work our way through this best of five match in our first semifinal. I will remind you that we've got Patrick Dickmann from Germany facing off against Ivan Flock from Slovakia. That's coming up next after the conclusion of this match. But let's just stay right here and see who is going to advance to the finals. Is it going to be Luis Scott-Vargas? Is it going to be JC Tao? Reasonable start for both players here, both playing two mana spells on the first turn of the game. JC on the play after having lost the last game, and he's got an Eldrazi Sky Spawner to follow up, the endless one that he played for two on the first turn. See if Luis can have an explosive start of his own. He does. He plays a four mana spell, Thought Not Seer, on his second turn. He even gets a look at what JC's working with, and JC's working with a lot here. I see at least two Drowner of Hope in that mess. And is that an Eldrazi Obligator in there too?
Yes, looks to be the case. One of the cards that is credited as giving the blue-red deck an edge in the mirror match here.
So, Luis has to decide what he wants to do.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I'd be looking at here is the Thought Not Seer. There is a Scion there, putting JC up to four mana on board to be able to cast that. Yeah, it looks like that's Luis's choice there.
Yeah, he takes away the Thought Not Seer, and now he's going to crash in with the Eldrazi Mimic that's now a 4-4. And he is actually going to go ahead and proactively gut shot an Eldrazi Scion here to make sure that nothing crazy happens on this next turn. Four cards in hand for Scott-Vargas.
Yeah, I really like that mana denial line of play there. I think Luis is just thinking if JC stumbles for just one more turn, missing his land drop this turn, it's going to put Luis in a really awesome spot. But actually not a bad one there for JC Tao. He does pick up a second Eldrazi Sky Spawner, which is sort of a great balance of adding presence to the board, but also adding a little bit of mana in terms of the Scion that he picks up there. Luis coming into this turn with not a lot of additional pressure in his hand. We will see what he did pick up from his draw step.
Well, he is going to go ahead and attack with Thought Not Seer, which is going to prompt a double block here. Ooh, and the door was open for a 2-for-1, and Luis rarely turns those down. So Dismember is going to...
Yeah, not an ideal use of Dismember in this matchup. I think it's, you know, something you generally kind of want to save for...
For some of the big, the reality
for some of the big
smashers
stuff like Reality
stuff?
Smasher or Thought Not Seer or what have you. But yeah, I mean, Luis just wanting it to set up the the block
so
there.
Is the Thought Not Seer in the graveyard actually?
Sorry if we're sounding a little confused here. We were wondering the same thing, why that Thought Not went in the graveyard.
Did it come back? All right, it came back.
It should have remained on the battlefield. Whole point of Luis using the Dismember there was to take out the Endless One and make the Thought Not Seer survive combat there.
Right, so. I noticed it down in... Yeah.
But yeah, as I was saying, from JC's standpoint, I would kind of view that as a little bit of weakness in Luis's hand, just in that, like, using a Dismember to take out a 2-2 creature kind of says that Luis really, really wants to just continue attacking with that Thought Not Seer, perhaps because he doesn't have a lot of extra pressure going on in his hand right now.
You know, another upside to that we've seen throughout the course of the weekend from this blue-red Eldrazi deck from the East-West Bowl team is that the addition of Ruination Guide really benefits them having a wide board state. And if you can, trim down just how many creatures they have in general, you can mitigate that a bit. So there's other upsides happening here by just taking out two creatures, even if they're not really the most impressive ones on the battlefield.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an Eldrazi Obligator here for Tao. Mutavault Matter Reshaper. Make this into a 3-2. Attack for 3. Tao takes a look at his life pad there. He's at 14. And he hasn't decided yet if he wants to make a block or not. He's got blocks.
Yeah, I think trading the Obligator for the Mimikyu would be totally reasonable. Or, yeah, even the Sky Spawner.
Sure.
Either of those makes a lot of sense.
He's going to do exactly that, and Luis is just going to pass the turn back. Oh, there's a Thought Not Seer off the top for Tao, which is going to take away the Spellskite in hand and leave Luis with just an Urborg.
So the important thing here is JC is just on the brink of being able to play Drowner of Hope. He actually has 2 copies in his hand. He's got 2 lands, Eye of Ugin discounts by 2, so that's 4, plus a Scion is 5. So if he hits any land here, he can actually start playing those Drowners, and that's going to be a huge step in the right direction for him.
Instead, he finds a Vile Aggregate. So still doesn't have the ability to get one of those Drowners online, but once he does, he should be able to pull away from this game. As things have come to a bit of a halt here at 12 life apiece in game number 3.
Yeah, Luis was looking great in the early game here, but as things stand, it's actually kind of shifting more toward the way JC Tao wants the game to play out. These big board stalls, I think, definitely benefit him with cards like Drowner of Hope in his deck. Being able to fly over with Sky Spawners or maybe top deck another Eldrazi Obligator. I think the board stalls generally favor the blue-red Eldrazi deck.
And there it is. He finally finds the land, and Drowner of Hope hits the battlefield, and that's the first of what is going to be 2 Drowner of Hopes.
Yeah, and actually a big deal that was an Eldrazi Temple lets him save the Scion he already had in play, and that represents an extra tap, which in many ways is like half an extra time walk given the board state right now.
And you know what? JC Tao is currently mapping out exactly how this would go and if he can kill Luis in a turn or two. Remember, JC is at 11. He's got a pretty reasonable life total piled up here. And I think that over the next 2 turns, he can engineer it so that he just kills Luis.
Yeah, he's actually, it could be actually one off lethal right now. If he has 2 Scions to tap the 2 creatures there, and then Luis can activate a creature land, the 3rd Scion taps that, and it would be Thought Not Seer getting through for 4, Obligator for 3, that's 7, and the Vile Aggregate would be 4 with the remaining non-Scion creatures. So that's 11 damage. So I believe he's one off right now.
Putting Luis to 1 doesn't sound terrible.
Yeah, although I actually think JC can probably just wait till next turn, play a second Drowner of Hope, and then, you know, just comfortably have lethal damage that turn. And the one danger is if Luis does top deck a Thought Not Seer.
Mm. Yeah, that's going to happen either way. He does just pass a turn here.
There's also possibilities. Oh, all right then.
There's the Thought Not Seer that you mentioned, but JC couldn't have done anything about that either
way.
Yeah,
that's true.
But wow, he loses a Drowner of Hope there, so rip.
He may have taken the opportunity to put Luis to 1 had he known for sure that was coming up. But
I mean, you said it.
Playing the probabilities here.
JC can't hear you, thankfully. JC still advantaged here on board, but does not attack, just passes the turn back to Luis Scott-Vargas, who finds a second Mutavault.
Yeah, and this is getting, like, sort of uncomfortable on both sides here in the sense that, like, both boards are big enough that either player could easily end the game in one attack, just if things balance out just right. So JC's actually kind of checked by Luis's creatures right now. He can't really use his science to tap Luis's board and move in, because then Luis would have easily a lethal crackback. So JC maybe, you know, just needs to kind of be patient here until he hits another Drowner of Hope, or maybe gets enough lands that he can start activating Eye of Ugin. Although Luis is ahead in the Eye of Ugin race here. And one interesting thing is if JC gets a little bit closer to being able to activate Eye of Ugin, he can actually start sacrificing a Scion or two to start activating his Eye and maybe getting a little bit ahead that way.
Oh, he's drawn a Dismember for the turn, which is going to take out the Thought Knot Seer. He's going to get a card back off of that as well, though Tao does fall to 7 after using that Dismember.
Yeah, I wonder if he intentionally didn't tap for black mana there. I mean, he could have tapped 3 because Luis does have an Urborg, I think, right?
Oh, yeah, Luis definitely has an Urborg.
Yeah, I wonder if he just valued keeping his lands untapped to get the extra tempo there and didn't really care about his life total, or maybe just wasn't thinking about using the Urborg there.
Possible.
Interesting either way.
Yeah. You'd think he'd want to preserve his life total at this point.
Yeah, I would think so, although the board is clogged up enough that he may just say,
I'm not dying this next turn to damage
anytime soon.
That's fair.
I'm not sure.
That did leave him the opportunity to top deck another Drowner of Hope and just went on the spot, I'm assuming.
Yeah, so that may be what he was thinking there.
All right, it looks like JC is finally ready to start rumbling here. He's lining up an attack with Vile Aggregate. How big is that right now? 3, 4, 7, 7?
Yeah, it does get smaller if he decides to use any science to tap creatures, but he might not need to. He might be able
to. 7, 5. Yeah, it's just bigger.
Just attack with the Vile Aggregate. Luis would either have to trade. Huh, what's going on here?
So what's happening is he's activating Eye of Ugin by tapping one of them for black mana, then playing another one, legend ruling the tapped one out, and then tapping the next one for black thanks to Urborg.
And sacrificed a Scion there as well.
He sacrificed a Scion, and then he had to tap, of course, the last Eye of Ugin there as part of its ability.
So I imagine we're grabbing a Drowner of Hope here.
That does seem to be the case.
Make two more Scions and then be able to tap down a bunch.
That's what he got. Yeah, Ian, you called it. And it's looking like JC Tao might maybe be able to finish things off here.
Oh, wow. So this is Luis' end of turn pitch as a Simian Spirit Guide for the surprise Eye of Ugin activation.
Wow, he was one mana short on board, so JC felt like he was fine. But immediately Luis cracks it.
Yep.
And he is going to play a Thought Knot Seer, and you know what he's going to see there. Drowner of Hope.
Yeah, and because JC needed to do the Eye of Urborg trick on his main phase, replacing one with the other, he actually had to main phase that Eye of Ugin activation, leaving the Drowner vulnerable in his hand, and that made Luis's play possible there. So really, really nice play from Luis.
So a Thought Knot Seer is going to take away the Drowner, and there's also a Reality Smasher here for Luis off the top. Does he have any attacks?
I mean, he can offer the Reality Smasher to trade with either the Vile Aggregate or the Drowner of Hope. Yeah, I imagine it would trade with the Vile Aggregate.
Well, you know what? There's also an issue because JC could just trade. Well, he's got a lot of options here as far as trades go. All right, he decides on the Vile Aggregate. He takes no damage from that, but it does get the biggest creature off the battlefield here. Now what, JC? Do you have enough mana to activate that thing again? No. Passes a turn back.
I wonder what JC drew there. Seems like if he had a land, he would have played it. If he drew a creature, he would have played it. So it's either like another Dismember. Eye of Ugin or a reactive card, like a Dismember maybe.
I think it was maybe the Thought Knot Seer last turn. He just didn't want to fire it off with nothing in hand, but he does play it here as well as the Vile Aggregate that he drew.
Yeah, I think he realizes for the most part, Luis is not going to be sitting on any cards in hand for the rest of this game.
Yeah, there's a few cards that Luis could have, and here we go, Oblivion Sower. And this is what we've seen from these mirror matches, and I use that term loosely because these decks are not that similar, even though they use the same mana engine at the base of it all. But this is how you win these fights, is you become the person who gets to start activating Eye of Ugin and searching up a steady stream of threats. And now he gets to play Oblivion Sower, maybe find some lands. In fact, he does find two. And even handy-dandy here, that Scalding Tarn does tap for black mana because Luis doesn't have anything it can search up otherwise. And now he gets to just keep chaining through these Eye of Ugin activations and start dominating the board. Also, Oblivion Sower, really nice blocker against the typical threats that you see from the other Eldrazi decks, Reality Smashers, that kind of thing.
Definitely true.
All right, combat has been called here. Luis says, sure. What do you got? He's got a pair of Mutavaults and a pair of Blink Moth. Nexus is sitting down there as well as his entire board state, including an Oblivion Sower. But JC still has a Drowner of Hope and two Scions that he can use to at least mitigate some of the blockers. Okay, and JC is attacking. Those four creatures in the middle are attacking. He's going to activate his Drowner of Hope to tap down the Oblivion Sower, the biggest blocker that Luis has, and Luis needs to survive this any way that he can. Now, he'd love to try to maintain his mana advantage here as well so he can keep activating Eye of Ugin. Looks like he's going to be able to do that pretty easily.
So Luis does have a copy of Dismember in hand, which is definitely going to be an influence in combat here.
Okay, so it looks like both of the Blink Moth Nexus are both of the Mutavaults are active here. And Luis is lining up some pretty nice looking blocks here. Does he have enough mana to use the ability on both of the Blink Moths on the Mutavaults? Because one Mutavault jumped in front of the 4/4 Thought Knot Seer.
Yeah, that's very interesting. The problem is he can't do that and dismember, and I don't think he wants to let that vile aggregate hit him. I imagine he's going to be dismembering either the aggregate or the Thought Knot Seer, depending on whether he wants the extra card or prevent more damage.
Makes sense. So that makes that Mutavault just a chump block then?
Does look to be the case.
Yeah, but he is going to trade Mutavault and a Matter Reshaper. He tapped his other Mutavault.
Ian. Oh, right, yes.
We missed the blocking Mutavault there.
The blocking Mutavault.
It all works out there
so
as a trade.
Yeah, your play made sense there.
Yeah, so now he gets actually two cards here, right? He gets one off of the Thought Knot Seer, and he gets one off of the Matter Reshaper. Well, it looks like he did that right, because the Eldrazi Mimic hits the battlefield off of the Reshaper, and he draws, I think, another Oblivion Sower, actually.
Wow, so that Mimic going straight onto the battlefield could be a huge deal here.
Wow.
Now it's going to be able to attack this turn.
There it is, Oblivion Sower, exile the top four, and that does it. Luis Scott-Vargas grinds that one through.
Awesome, awesome comeback from Luis.
And he is now up 2-1 in this match, and that was a sweet one. And again, it came down to the Eye of Ugin on Luis's side with enough mana to activate it.
Well, even before that, it was the Thought Knot Seer off the top
that
to take the second
huge
Drowner, right?
You did that. That was you, Ian.
I suggested the possibility.
One question that we have that came in from Twitter. Somebody on Twitter wants to know, why is there gut shot in these decks? They said, look, I get that it's some type of technology being brought in, but what is it for?
Well, it's really good to sideboard in when you're predicting a game where your opponent's going to end up at one life. So that's the main purpose for it. The backup thing is it's great at killing. It's great at killing Eldrazi Mimics, which is one of the easiest ways to run away with a game in the Eldrazi Mirror Match. Right? We saw it, in game one there. Double Eldrazi Mimic plus Endless One off of Eye of Ugin. So Gutshot is awesome there.
So it's basically just the finisher. That's what I heard you say.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, that's in an Eldrazi deck, yeah. Gutshot's a finisher. All right, so we looked at Reality Smasher earlier as one of the really powerful options for this Eldrazi deck that's been doing a lot of work. But I honestly, I think the absolute all-star, the thing that pins this whole deck together is Thought Not Seer. That seems to be the card of this deck, if I have to pick one, I mean, outside of the lands, of course. Tell us about Thought Not Seer.
Yeah, so Thought Not Seer came out of a desire to find some interesting and unique abilities that colorless mana could get sort of as part of its pseudo color pie, where it like doesn't cleanly fit exactly into what another color is doing. So it was definitely inspired by Vendilion Click, but I thought about what about it like a slow action Vendilion Click, where you get the card right away, but then if the Thought Not Seer dies later, your opponent gets to draw a card to replace it. And it's actually pretty interesting because there are times when you cast a Thought Not Seer and your opponent doesn't have any non-land cards in your hand, and then the Thought Not's body actually becomes a liability, where if it dies now, your opponent is actually up a card on you. That said, in Modern, where you have these super powerful lands turboing out these Eldrazi, an early game Thought Not Seer is a lot more likely to see a non-land card in your opponent's hand. And so this is a card that actually gets super duper powered up by the presence of Eye of Ugin and Eldrazi Temple compared to where it would be at in Standard.
Card's unreal, dude.
It is a very strong card.
Yeah, it is fantastic, and it has been doing savage work here all weekend. And we saw, you know, you mentioned it right there, that Thought Not Seer off the top allowed Luis to transition into the late game and ultimately win game number 3 and put himself up 2-1 over JC Tao here. All right, well, it looks like the players just about ready here. So we can start up our 4th game here. Now, this could be a decider on who goes into the finals. If it is a decider, well, that means that Luis Scott-Vargas is in the finals. And, of course, if it's not, then we're going to get a 5th game. Now, it looks like JC is going to be on the play here, but not play anything on the first turn. Luis Scott-Vargas plays the all-important Eye of Ugin here on turn 1, but doesn't have any other plays. There's the Eye for JC Tao, who's going to play an Endless One. And not bad. Not a bad response here for Luis Scott-Vargas. He plays a Wastes and then a Matter Reshaper. So looks good for Luis so far in the early stages, but JC's not done yet. Here's a Thought Not Seer. And this is, well, this is what you just described a minute ago, Ian, an early game Thought Not Seer. Look at all the options he's got here.
Yeah, two actually really, really good options here. There's the Reality Smasher and the opposing Thought Not Seer. Now, because Luis does have an Urborg in hand, he can play that and actually have access to 5 mana on turn 3 there. So he could play his Reality Smasher or his Thought Not Seer. So it's on JC to decide which one he wants to face less here. And it looks like he does take away that Thought Not Seer. Now, one cool thing, and I'm not sure if whether or not JC picked up on this, I assume he did, is that he saw Luis's last land was Urborg. So assuming Luis has to play the Urborg here to play the Reality Smasher, that actually turns on JC's Eye of Ugin, which turns on the Dismember in his hand. So, like,
it does.
Assuming he planned that out, if he decides to dismember here, that's a really nice sequence on his part.
He does not.
Okay.
So Reality Smasher hits for Luis Scott-Vargas, and it also hits JC.
And one of the reasons for that, or one thing we may see coming up here, I should say, is I do spy a copy of Eldrazi Obligator in JC's hand.
Okay. And now, hold on a second. I think we may need to back up. He may have not decided yet if he's blocked or not.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. So it looks like JC is going to take this moment here to tap that for mana and take out the Reality Smasher. It does make him discard a card, though. So that worked out pretty well for Tao.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Oh, and this worked out really well for Tao. Goodness. And this is just punch, counterpunch here in the feature match area. That was 12 damage, Ian.
Yeah, and you know what, Marshall? That makes the remaining Eldrazi Obligator in JC's hand almost a hard lock on this game, unless, again, Luis can top deck a Thought Not Seer to take that out now.
Let's see if he has it. No, he's got a Spellskite, that fix the problem?
It helps with the problem.
He also has a Mutavault back there.
Yep, we'll have to calculate combat math here, but one of the things Spellskite can do is actually redirect that triggered ability from the Eldrazi Obligator to the Spellskite.
Does look like it's going to cost him 2 life to do that. That might change the math enough on its own. Let's see what JC Tao does for the turn, and then we'll start sorting that out. There it is, Obligator. And he's going to go ahead and target the Matter Reshaper.
Yeah.
He does have to pay.
Looks like this is going to be perhaps not a lethal attack, but, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Looks like it is.
It's lethal. So, wow, these games are so fast. That is JC Tao evening things up. And we're going to get a game five between these before we find our first semifinalist. You know, I got to tell you, these games don't last super long, but boy, are they exciting. They pack in some real punches here. And this last one I have high expectations for as well. Is it going to be JC Tao? Is it going to be Luis Scott-Vargas? JC from Team East West Bowl, this is his third Pro Tour, period.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And they've also all been recent. You know, I think he's played something like three of the last four Pro Tours, three of the last five, something in that range. When we look, of course, at Luis Scott-Vargas' resume, well, it's a little longer than that.
Yeah, I really like the story of the Team East-West Bowl for this tournament. It's sort of a collection of players who didn't necessarily have a home prior to this Pro Tour, maybe had bounced around between different teams or hadn't had a team yet, or, you know, maybe their first couple times in the Pro Tour. And they sort of all banded together, you know, from across different regions and put together a really, really stellar performance in this tournament. And, you know, for a set that's all about teamwork, I really appreciate the story of these teams really coming together and doing awesome work.
So we got kind of a cool setup here in Atlanta this time, by the way. We're sitting not in our normal, we call it the Whisper Cube. That's the soundproof booth that we're normally in. We're actually out in the crowd here, and I see we've got a really nice crowd, and we're going to bring them up on the screen. You can see everybody wave. There they are. And you can see there's cheering sections for both of our players here as well. And everybody is joining Ian and I for this exciting ride that is the semifinals as we work our way up to the finals. Everybody's having a good time here. A little quiet. Crowd's a little quiet. They're sort of intensely embroiled in this as well.
Yeah, I mean, these are pretty, pretty intense matchups.
Now, there was a question there, and I was trying to take a look at this, but the game ended so quickly as well. And what the conversation is about was, did JC have colorless mana available to activate, to pay the triggered ability on his Obligator? Because it is one generic and one colorless, and the mana that he had available, he didn't actually have actual colorless.
Oh.
He could make black mana, basically.
I see. Is that definitely the case here, or are we still investigating?
You know, I think that the Kevin Dupre, our head judge, was down there chatting with the players. And it looks like that was the case, which results in a warning.
Okay.
Yeah, but you can't go back.
Yeah, it's an unfortunate thing. You know, I'm sure it was an honest mistake. Neither player caught it in time. The game concluded. There's really no way to resolve that besides, you know, just simply issue a warning and sort of the result stands and moving onwards.
That's right. And onwards we go. So this is going to be intense. Mm-hmm. I'm just hoping that both players get to keep their openers and we get a real nice little game here.
Yeah, I hope so too. These games, as you said, Marshall, they're fast, but they're exciting. And the thing with these aggressive, fast games, everything is so high impact that each decision matters so much. You know, it may seem like it's just sort of, okay, I'm curving out, I'm playing these powerful lands, powerful creatures, but there's a lot of really, really impactful hard decisions in these games. What do I take with a Thought Knot? How do I sequence my creatures? How do I attack and block? Do I take a gamble that my opponent doesn't have a Reality Smasher and come in for a big attack knowing that I'll die on the crackback if they do? A lot of things like that. And yeah, these have been really, really exciting to see play out.
All right, players are examining their opening sevens here for this fifth and deciding game in our first semifinal match. We're going to be bringing you Patrick Dickmann and Yvonne Flock after this game. And this is a mulligan for Luis Scott-Vargas, and I think that JC's kept his hand. Looks like he may be still thinking, but he's got seven cards in hand still, so in any case, not an immediate mulligan. Yeah, it looks like he's kept here.
I'll show my hand after I
shuffle. Okay, so Luis Scott-Vargas going down to six. He does get to be on the play here, which is a big deal. We saw in game one, JC had one of those insane draws.
Now let's see if Luis Scott-Vargas can keep his six card opener here. Viewers at home can get a at least fleeting glance at what his hand looks like here. Looks like three lands, Oblivion Sower, Endless One.
Yeah, this is a tough one for Luis here. No double lands in his hand means he's going to be coming out pretty slow. Even though he's got lands and spells, I just think against another Eldrazi deck where they kept seven, if JC comes out with a fast hand with a double land.
Yeah, any of them.
Hand just not fast enough to keep
No,
up.
Not at all. I mean, we are looking at a situation there where there is a realistic chance that Luis's first play of the game is a Mattery Shaper on turn three or a 3/3.
Yeah, that's just
endless
like a,
one.
That's just a death sentence.
Jeez, I mean, there's limited draws that can beat that. That's just not going to get the job done. So Luis is going to go down to five and see if he can't find something better.
Looks like another not-so-great one here.
No,
see
this looks like
Ghost Quarter.
He's got Mimic, Ghost Quarter, Oblivion Sower, Reality Smasher. I don't know if this is a keep either. All right, he has kept it. He gets that scry, and he's going to put it on top. So
okay.
That could be good
That's
news
good
for
step.
Luis Scott-Vargas. Could be better news for JC Tao, though, as he's the one on seven cards, though he is on the draw. So Ghost Quarter go from Luis, and we'll see in a second what Luis decided to keep on top of his library with his scry there.
When we take a look at Tao's hand here, Tao's hand is good. He has both Eye and Eldrazi Temple. He's going to have a turn two Ruination Guide into a turn three Reality Smasher into a turn four Reality Smasher.
Whoa.
So, yikes.
So what happened with Luis was that he did keep a land on top. It was an Eldrazi Temple. And he just sort of flicks his hand onto the table. There's nothing he can do at this point as Thought Not Seer examines the hand here and looks to take one card away. It's Eldrazi Mimic, Oblivion Sower, Reality Smasher, and Tao just has to figure out how to piece together a win here. It feels like he has the tools to do so. He took the Reality Smasher.
Yep. I think one of the only ways Tao could lose this game is if Luis hit, say, an Eye of Ugin or a second Eldrazi Temple there, played a Smasher, copied it, got in for 10, and then continued the beat down there. So taking the Smasher, definitely a huge deal.
Speaking of Smashers, crunch. There's five damage right at you, Luis Scott-Vargas, and you've only got a couple of turns to find something here. And he can't do it. He's passed the turn back two turns in a row. No, he actually didn't pass a turn back. So what he did is he decided to exile the Simium Spirit Guide, play an Endless One for four, and smash with the Mimics here. He's doing the best he can with this hand. And Tao has to go in the tank. I think that JC has the feeling here, Ian, that this is his game to win or to lose, and he just needs to make sure that he plays sound magic here.
Definitely true.
So Luis attempting to make this a race. He's got Tao down to 12. JC's hitting land drops. He's got two different lands that are effectively producing two mana. And there's an Eldrazi Obligator. And he's going to steal the 4/4, and everybody's in. Luis Scott-Vargas extends the hand. JC Tao is our first finalist. So JC Tao, again, he's from Seattle area. He's from East-West Bowl, and he's got blue-red Eldrazi, and he just defeated Luis Scott-Vargas 3-2 in an intense semifinal match to put himself in that seat.
Mm-hmm.
So he's in.
All right.
To the finals. Congratulations to JC. Condolences to Luis. Another awesome run. I know a lot of his fans were happy to see him once again in the top eight, you know, where he belongs. We're going to try to convince him to come in the booth, see if he can shake it off. But fantastic stuff there from both players. And once again, congratulations to JC Tao for taking that first finalist seat. I mean, again, this is his third Pro Tour. And he just put himself in the finals.
Yeah, incredible accomplishment.
He's one five-game match away from taking home a trophy and going from being somebody who's qualified a few times to somebody who is on the train, as we say, platinum and all that kind of stuff.
So, yeah.
Really great storyline.
What comes from him down the road.
Yeah, I'm really excited and to see if he can put it together. But, of course, that does mean that we have one more semifinal to go, which we'll be working our way towards here as the players are going to get seated and get everything figured out for that. It's going to be Patrick Dickmann from Germany. He's going to be playing against Ivan Flock. And more on that, Rich at the news desk.
Thanks very much to Marshall and Ian. Rich and Randy here with you to guide you towards semi-final two. Now, if you're just joining us, where have you been? You've missed an absolute treat. Tons of Eldrazi running around, affinity decks aplenty. Why don't we take a look at our bracket here on the final day of Pro Tour Oath of the Gatewatch, and we'll show you what's been happening. So, Randy, we began our morning with Shuhei Nakamura against Jiachen Tao. And Tao won that one by 3-1 in a match that it looked like he was slightly favored to win.
Yeah, the word is East-West Bowls Eldrazi is pretty good heads up against Channel Fireball Eldrazi, and all six of Shuhei's top eights could not actually help him.
All right, so then we moved on. At the same time, Luis Scott-Vargas was playing against Pascal Maynard. And this one, well, it was Colorless Eldrazi against Affinity, and it went the distance.
Yeah, super close, tight five-game match, absolutely. But Luis did, in fact, get there in the end to advance to the semis.
Now, is that what you would have expected in terms of the decks, or was that more about play or just the way the cards fell?
I think Affinity versus Colorless Eldrazi, it is close. It is definitely close. Play skill can matter. Draws definitely matter. I thought Luis played really, really well. And not that Pascal played badly, but I mean, it's one where Luis was really on top of his game and in good form. And I think that helped him get to the semis.
So that was quarterfinals 1 and 2. Then we moved to the bottom half of the bracket. And we saw another first timer in the top eight arena. Andrew Brown of Team East-West Bowl, again playing the blue-red colorless Eldrazi deck. And he was up against the second affinity deck in the tournament. That was Patrick Dickmann of Germany. And this is the one, Randy, that was not close. Patrick Dickmann, straight 3-0 sweep.
That was impressive. Patrick just looked great. It was another one where I actually think the blue-red Eldrazi deck ought to be a little better against affinity than colorless is. But you couldn't tell from the game. Patrick just swept him 3-0.
Yep, but hats off to Andrew Brown for making it into the top eight.
I mean, that whole team, four guys played that deck. Three of them got 8 or 9 wins with it. Like, they had three guys had three losses between them, and two of them made the top eight. Just absolutely crushed this tournament.
Yeah, phenomenal. And when
like
you look
31-8-1 was their record.
Right, and when you compare that to the 20 players who are on Channel Fireball and face-to-face, which are, you know, 30% Hall of Fame, 45% Pro Tour champions. And East-West Bowl, let's be fair, maybe those things are in the future, but they're not there yet. They don't have Hall of Famers. They don't have Pro Tour
champions.
They have, you
know, some Grand Prix top eights.
Right. But maybe they're about to have a Pro Tour champion because they're one five-game set away right now. But Patrick Dickmann advanced in quarterfinal 3. Quarterfinal 4 at the bottom of our bracket, if we take a look, that was Ivan Flock of Slovakia up against Frank Lepore of the United States. So this was two different flavors of Eldrazi.
Yeah.
We had the colorless Eldrazi mirrored with Luis Scott-Vargas and Shuhei Nakamura's deck, Ivan Flock on the same team. Frank Lepore, though, Randy, had a third take on the Eldrazi.
Yeah, his is more processor flavored. It's black base, so Wasteland Strangler, which is a card from Battle for Zendikar that was starting to see some play on Magic Online in Eldrazi decks even before Oath of the Gatewatch came out. And, you know, Frank did a lot of his testing on Magic Online, so it's almost the crowdsourced version of the Eldrazi deck. And another good take on the archetype. A lot of powerful things going on there. I gotta say, though, I mean, I was talking about how well Luis was playing. Ivan Flock is another guy who's just so good at Magic. I mean, him moving over from cabin crew to face-to-face games for this tournament, actually, you know, you've now got 19 other people now who are just like, I didn't realize how good Ivan Flock was. Oh my God, he's just great at the game.
Yeah, and the interesting thing there is that when he came to prominence, it was with control decks. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and we're partly responsible for that narrative. We talk about him liking blue or blue-white if he must, or Esper if that's all there is. You know, but he said, no, I'm actually committed to the best deck, right, which is how Luis learned to take the step from just below the best to the very best. He said, I'm not interested in my own brew. I'm interested in identifying the best deck and then learning to play it better than anyone else.
That's a great point.
And if you can do that, well, that puts you into the Hall of Fame category. But it was even Flock who advanced by 3-2. So then we moved to our semifinals after lunch, and that brought Jiachen Tao up against Luis Scott-Vargas. Tao had already vanquished Luis's teammate Shuhei Nakamura with Colorless Eldrazi and was looking to do it all over again. Randy, did he?
JC Tao could win this entire tournament playing nothing but Colorless Eldrazi decks.
And nothing but Channel Fireball.
He's already taken out one Channel Fireball player. He's taken out another Channel Fireball player. 12 Pro Tour top eights vanquished.
Right.
If we see even Flock win this semifinal.
Who is, of course, face-to-face, because they're combined for this tournament.
Fair, but 75-card identical deck with the one that Luis and Shuhei are playing, JC Tao could just run the whole table that way. It would be kind of crazy.
Yeah, Luis sort of dodged a bullet in the fact that his deck malfunction in the quarterfinals happened in game 4.
Yeah.
He mulliganed to 4. The deck malfunction this time really cost him. It happened in game 5, and there is no comeback from that.
No, and there is a thing in Modern right now, because these decks, because the first couple turns are so important, because you come out of the gate super fast, and that, especially in the Eldrazi-Eldrazi match, that match can often be decided by turn 3. Not like somebody gets killed on turn 3, but just you came out, so you got so far ahead that the other guy can't catch up. You're supposed to mulligan aggressively. Like, it is correct strategy to mulligan aggressively. I mean, 5-4, obviously you don't want to be down at 4 cards, but it's almost like that 7-6 and a scry. First one's almost free. Like, it's just correct if your hand is at all below average to go fishing and see if you can do better.
Okay.
And I also want to say that game 3 that Luis played was amazing. I feel like Luis only even got to game 5 of what is admittedly a bad matchup because he played lights out in game 3 in particular.
Well worth watching the tape back on that one then. But it's time to turn our attention to semi-final 2. And this is Patrick Dickmann of Germany. You see Jiachen Tao moving forward. He will face the winner of Patrick Dickmann and Even Flock. So why don't we take a look at Patrick Dickmann for you. He's from Germany. He's playing in his second Pro Tour Top 8, the Grand Prix Antwerp champion from 2013, closing in on 100 lifetime pro points, and he is playing Affinity. Let's take a look at his list. And Randy, this is a pretty straightforward list. It's the kind of thing we've seen for a long time in Modern. This is your old school Modern deck.
Oh yeah, and this is, he was one of the Affinity aficionados. Frank Karsten sort of led this effort to have Affinity players from a lot of the big teams actually kind of get together sort of behind closed doors.
And in like the virtual corner.
Yeah, we promise we won't talk about any of the other team decks, we're only talking about Affinity, and they did. And Patrick and Frank were among those players. Alec Magelton was in that group, who just got together and talked about what's the right way to attack this field with Affinity. So,
yep, Dickmann's here in the semifinals, and he will face Even Flock. Now, across the studio waiting for us is another member of Team Face-to-Face Games. It's a very familiar face. It's the reigning player of the year. Here comes Mike Sigrist.
Mike Sigrist, welcome to the not-so-comfy chairs here. Tell me something, though. We've talked a lot about this Channel Fireball deck, but this is actually, we had Jacob Wilson in to do a deck tech yesterday. This actually came out of the Face-to-Face Games half of this collective. What was the process of developing this deck? Like, how long did it take for people to get on this deck?
Well, we spent the first few days testing all the, stock decks and stuff, and this was really the only new deck that we thought was competitive. So once we realized that it was, could be top tier, we actually just had all 13 people working on it, tuning it, playing all the matchups, and figuring out where the last few slots, the flex slots we call them, to be able to compete with the metagame we expected.
Does Even Flock think he can advance to the finals here and defend the honor of the collective against the blue-red Eldrazi deck?
He is probably the least confident of all of us that he will win, but yeah, he knows he's got a good shot, yeah.
All right, Mike Sigrist, thanks for coming in and talking to us, sending it back to the desk, and imminently, some more magic.
All right, thanks very much to Brian David Marshall. Let's just take a look then at Even Flock's career for you. We'll show you his record. He is, of course, a Pro Tour champion, Even Flock, from Magic 2015. This is his third Pro Tour top eight. He's got the sweep, a Grand Prix champion, a Team World champion, a Pro Tour champion.
This is a guy who's starting to enter the Hall of Fame conversation.
Right, and certainly the next 2 to 3 hours could make a difference to that. Yeah. All right, so that's Even Flock. It is time here in Atlanta, Georgia, for the second semifinal of Pro Tour Oath of the Gatewatch.